Welcome everyone to the Zoom call, alumni, students, and parents, and other community members. Thank you for joining us today. My name is Adina, and I'm a senior at Brandeis, and I've been involved in Hillel in various ways on the student board and in other member groups. We are so delighted to have all of you here tonight to welcome our special guest speaker, Professor Reuven Kimelman, who is going to share his personal story in his talk about political protest from Hanukkah to the war in Vietnam, a personal odyssey. For those of you who don't know Professor Kimelman, he is a professor in Near Eastern and Judaic Studies at Brandeis University. And Professor Kimelman specializes in the history of Judaism with a focus on the history and poetics of Jewish liturgy. He's written on the interaction between Judaism and Christianity in antiquity and modernity. He is also interested in the thematic connections between Greek and biblical literature from Homer to Plato and from Genesis to Matthew. In the field of Jewish ethics, his focus is on the ethics of war, statecraft, conflict, and genocide. He's written extensively on his mentor, Abraham Joshua Heschel, and published a book on Lecha Dodi. Professor Kimelman is known for his novel and thought-provoking interpretations of Jewish texts, and I'm sure tonight's talk will give us all a lot to think about. Regarding the format of tonight's program, Professor Kimelman will speak for about 20 minutes and then we'll follow up with questions from the audience. So if you have any questions, please post them in the main chat rather than messaging Professor Kimelman. Post them in the main chat, please, so that we can read them to him and then he'll answer questions from the audience. I'm very excited for the rest of this talk, and we ask that you please remain muted for the entirety of the conversation. Thank you so much. And Professor Kimelman, the screen is yours.
Thank you. I just passed my first screen test. Anyhow, welcome to the sixth night of Hanukkah. Six down, two to go. And today, of course, also is Rosh Chodesh. So it's kind of a turning point, which brings with a turning point in my life in the 60s and its connection with Hanukkah. First, let me talk about Hanukkah, then talk about my life in the 60s, which kind of reflected the life of Jews who were intensely involved in Judaism and intensely involved in politics and found this double intensity converge in their lives and basically, for many of us, changed our lives. But first, I want to talk about Hanukkah because I'm a professor of liturgy. And a strange thing about Hanukkah is that Hanukkah in the prayer book is nothing like Hanukkah in the Talmud. If you know the story of Hanukkah in the Talmud, you focus upon the miracle of the oil for 8 days. If you read about Hanukkah in the liturgy, as it appears in the Amidah and the Al HaNisim prayer, it's all about the war and the victory, with no mention explicitly of the miracle of the 8 candles. So now the question, what is it? Do we celebrate a military victory? Is that the nace, the miracle? Or is the miracle of the 8 candles? It's like the famous story told about Israel during the 48 war, the war of independence, when Jerusalem was surrounded by the Jordanians. Someone asked the rabbi, what's going to happen? And the rabbi said, well, either we'll solve it by natural means or miraculous means. They said, what do you mean by natural means? Oh, that God will help us out. What do you mean by miraculous means? That the Israeli army will break through. That's how things were. Things have changed quite a bit since then. In any case, in Hanukkah, why is there no mention of the oil, all mentioned about the war? And it's done in a very strange way. At the very end of the prayer Al HaNisim, it gives several stages in the sanctification of the temple. It starts at the very middle of the temple, the Kodesh Kodeshim, its holy place, and works its way out. So the very middle, the most holy place, was called Devir Kodeshecha. Then they moved one step out to Eichal Lecha. Then they moved one step out to Mikdashecha, your temple. And finally, it says, they lit the candles or the lanterns in the courtyards of your temple, B'chatzrot Kodeshecha. So it goes from the sacred center to the periphery. It's an unusual religious drama and religious ritual. Starts at the sacred center and moves to the periphery. Then it says, and they fixed these 8 days of Hanukkah for expressions of gratitude. Now, almost anybody who reads this and does not read closely sees the word eight, sees the word candles, and automatically in his mind extrapolates. Candles, eight. Why do we light the candles? Because the candles lit for 8 days. But the prayer doesn't say that. The prayer simply says they lit candles and they fixed 8 days. And the prayer is totally based upon the book of Maccabees. The book of Maccabees explains the reason they kept the holiday for 8 days, because that year, Sukkot, which is a pilgrimage holiday, was not available. It was in the hands of the Greek or the Hellenizing Jews. 2 months later, in Kislev, when they took the sanctuary, they had to make up for the loss of Sukkot. So the regional name of Hanukkah was Sukkot de Kislev, Sukkot of the month of Kislev. Sukkot takes place over 8 days. Therefore, Hanukkah was commemorated for how many days? 8 days. The other explanation is that the original temple in the time of Solomon, the Hanukkah Bayit, the dedication of the temple, took 8 days after Sukkot. So the Maccabees calculated that if the original dedication was 8 days, then the rededication should be 8 days. So we have two explanations, historical explanations, for celebrating Hanukkah for 8 days. On the other hand, most people know their Talmud celebrate holiday 8 days because of the miracle of the oil. Now, the remarkable thing about this for the prayer is, whether you think that the candle burned for 8 days, or whether you think rededication took place 8 days, or whether you think we should have a compensatory holiday for the lack of Sukkot, the result is all Jews observe what? 8 days. It's a remarkable lesson that people can differ on their explanation, but if they agree upon the practice, the Jewish community is kept together. Now, how does that apply to the great events that took place in the 60s? In the 60s, there were four formative ethical events, at least for us Jews and for most young Americans at college. Most of them had two of them. We Jews had four of them. The first was the war in Vietnam, which started way back in the 1950s, really picked up by Kennedy and significantly promoted by Johnson. By the middle 60s, students at universities were being drafted. So the overwhelming number of people joined in the protest. In fact, I was at the first public demonstration when I was a student at Columbia University in 1964. As far as I can recall, that was the first teach-in to explore the ethical implications of the war in Vietnam and to subject public or foreign policy to ethical considerations. And where was it focused? At the university. Columbia University was one of the first students to do this and one of the last universities to riot in 1968. I was there at the riot, and that was the founding event from Vietnam. But in those days, I was very close to my mentor, Abraham Joshua Heschel, who was among a group of clergy who founded a group at St. John's Church way back in 1964 called Clergy Concerned for Vietnam. Now, it started off concerned for Vietnam, but by the end of the year, the atrocities, which were publicized on television in America, aroused ethical concern to such a degree that almost all people of strong ethical consideration opposed the war. And in those days, it wasn't Republican versus Democrat like it is now, because the war was primarily promoted by Democrats, Kennedy and Johnson, took over by Nixon, but it was independent of political allegiances. It was really a political versus a moral, as opposed to now, when almost all moral concerns get funded or fueled into political concerns, and you divide morally almost politically. There you found a large number of people coming together of different political allegiances, but of an intense moral allegiance. That came way back to 1964. I remember my teacher, Abraham Joshua Heschel, was a man of great love. And I can only recall in all the years I met him or knew him, only one person he hated, and that was Richard M. Nixon. Now, why did he hate Nixon? He hated Nixon, without getting involved in the war itself and everything he did, was in the abuse of the English language. So when Nixon was caught lying, he would say it's no longer operative. And Heschel's position was, if language does not have integrity, then ethics have no integrity. And if ethics have no integrity, then our soul has no integrity. That's what was his analysis. So from his point of view, Nixon lying about the war was undermining the moral integrity of American citizens by teaching them not to honor the spoken word. And he felt that the disease of not honoring the spoken word is a source of immoral life. Then the next major involvement I had in the 1960s was Russian Jewry. This was between Heschel and Wiesel. Wiesel went to Russia, came back and wrote Pont les Juifs de Silence, but went there at the urging of Abraham Joshua Heschel, who in 1964 was the first major Jewish figure to go public on this issue, claiming that we were quiet during the Second World War and we cannot be quiet again when a similar thing could be happening to us. Of course, the Second World War was maybe 6 to 7 million. Russian Jewry at that time may have been 2.5 million, but they were called the Jews of Silence because they had been silenced. And he took up the cudgels as if it were to compensate for the absence of doing anything by American Jewry or significantly doing anything during the Second World War. And the Russian Jewry 3 went out. So in 1964, when I was a student at Columbia University, a sophomore, we founded a group called the Student Struggle for Soviet Jewry. It's hard for you to imagine, in those days, our largest request was the right to send matzah to the Soviet Union. In light of what happened, it sounds absurd. But way back in 1964, nobody knew any Jews in the Soviet Union. Nobody was aware of any awareness of self-conscious Jews in the Soviet Union. Later on, Simchat Torah became a major event, but that was yet to take place. We were just protesting the right to send matzah. And that became the opening. And from there, the matzah, which is not exactly what it's always cracked up to be, became the opening for Soviet Jewry. That lasted through the 60s, through the 70s. But the student struggle for Soviet Jewry was allowed Jews, as Jews, to come out as political protests. So we had many protests at the United Nations. But we were protesting as Jews, many people wearing yarmulkes, wearing many other Jewish symbols. But it was convergence because until then, most Jews who protested did not protest as Jews, number one. Two, Judaism was not well accepted in the public realm. Most Jews, as they left the private realm into the public realm, would hide their Jewishness. So for example, when I was an undergraduate student at Columbia University, I wore a yarmulke, but most of my Orthodox friends wore hats, interesting enough, even though they were undergraduates at the university, because it wasn't yet acceptable for Jewishness to be expressed publicly, even by Jews who are quite proud of it. I was quite different from my contemporaries because I'd already spent a year and a half of my high school in Israel. In Israel, I was a part of a majority Jewish culture. Once you join a majority Jewish culture, it is psychologically liberating. Minority cultures are always a self-conscious. Majority cultures just do what's natural. So in America, I was a self-conscious Jew. In Israel, I became part of the majority culture, my expression of Jewishness. Coming back to America, I brought back the psychological liberation, which is a factor of majority culture, into the minority culture, and was able to lead other Jews in this issue. So we became a protesting group. The next thing which became excited almost everybody of an ethical conscience in the 60s was the civil rights movement. Also started, as you know, in the 50s, but really didn't pick up as a national movement with a lot of white people involved until the 60s. I say white people involved because there are two major expressions of this among young people. One was SNCC, which was an organization for the helping out of Negroes in the South. And the other was NSM, the Northern Student Movement. I was involved in both. I had volunteered to go down South to work on voter registration with SNCC. They rejected my application because the year before that, they said, we're only going to accept two types of people. Either whites from the South or blacks from the north is the way they express it. Whites from the south, blacks from the north. Otherwise, if you send whites from the north to the south, they'll be seen as carpetbaggers, if anyone knows the allusion after the Civil War. So I directed my energies to the NSM, Northern Student Movement, and was very involved in demonstrations, primarily in Harlem. Anyhow, I guess I'll tell you one example because you can learn a lot from this. We had an organization at Columbia University, and we were going to protest in Harlem. And then one of the black guys turned to me and said, "Reuven, you can't come with us." And I said, "Why can't I come with you? I helped plan the meeting." He said, "You can't come with us because you're white." I said, "What's wrong with being white?" He says, "What's wrong with being white is you have an option we don't have." I said, "What do you mean by that?" He said, "Well, in Harlem, I guarantee you the police are to come after us. You're white. You can disappear. We're black. They'll pursue us." And one guy turned to me and he said, "I can't trust somebody who has an option that I don't have. And since you can escape and I can't escape, I can't rely upon you. Therefore, don't come with us." It's a very honest statement, and I learned a lot about that in future Jewish protests. If a person has an option that you don't have at a time of distress and duress, you never know what they're going to do. Therefore, choose a person whose options are as limited as yours or as broad as yours. In the civil rights movement, we lived through even the death of King. But the beginning is that King gave a very famous speech in 1967 at the Riverside Church. And there he tied together the war in Vietnam with the civil rights movement. He had been encouraged in that direction and had tried for years not to make that connection for fear that if he went on one side of the war in Vietnam, he would lose the people who were supporting civil rights, but were opposed or supporting the war in Vietnam, and didn't want to split his political backing. In 1967, he gave a famous speech tying the two together and said, one is dependent upon the other because America does not have enough money for what it was, bread, for butter and guns. And if we spend the money on guns, we will not spend the money on poverty. And since poverty in his position and racism were significantly connected, then the solution of one should lead to the solution of the other. Anyhow, I heard that speech at the Riverside Church across from Columbia University. And I remember seeing my teacher come out, Abraham Joshua Heschel, and I saw him smiling. And I ran up to him and said, "Why are you smiling?" He says, "Because I won." I said, "What did you win?" And he said, "For a year, I've been trying to convince Martin," I guess he called him Martin, "to combine the two because civil rights movement cannot advance in this country unless we solve the problem of the war in Vietnam. And I finally convinced them, and boy, am I happy." Okay. The next major movement which came along was, of course, the Six-Day War. The Six-Day War in 1967 is right in the middle. If you think about the war in Vietnam picking up steam for students in 64, Russian Jewry, also 63, 64, 65, 66, became more powerful. The civil rights movement became stronger and stronger throughout the decade. For the Jews, the turning point was the war in Vietnam, the Six-Day War. Now, if you're too young, you probably don't recall this. But when the Six-Day War, before it broke out, there was 2 weeks where everybody thought Israel was going down the drain. India had removed its soldiers from the south of Israel. Egypt had blockaded the straits. And America declared public neutrality. And Israel was surrounded by two Arab armies. Three, Jordan joined. Lebanon didn't join that year because its pilot called in sick that year. Otherwise, everybody thought it. So the joke in Israel, because remember that, was if you're the last one to leave, turn out the lights. So 2 weeks before going into the war, people thought that Israel was going down the drain. Then the war broke out. The war broke out in the first 24 hours. We Jews in America only heard news from Arab countries. There's a total blockout of news from Israel. And we heard Radio Syria saying, "Put your sword in the body of a Jew and wash it off in the Mediterranean as you march through Haifa." That's all we knew. So on that day, most of it thought that Israel was going down the drain. It turned out that day that Israel had already destroyed the Arab air forces. Of course, even the Arabs didn't believe it because Jordan joined the second day of the war thinking that the Arabs were winning, not knowing that the war was already lost. In any case, tell your story. That day on New York TV, Channel 5, I remember to this day, they interviewed four people, Jews, on the war. And this is at a time we thought that Israel was losing the war. One person was the head of the American Jewish War Veterans. The other one was head of the American Jewish Committee. And the third person, I forgot who it was, and the fourth, representing New York Student Opinion, was yours truly. Anyhow, the interviewer started asking the people, and the first question was, why are you so distraught? And the head of the American Jewish Committee said, don't you realize that democracy is going down in the Middle East? Which I thought was hogwash. You think we were concerned about a democracy? We were concerned about losing our country. But American leaders had been taught in those days, you talk only in an idiom that you think Americans understand and does not accentuate the distinctiveness of being a Jew. So therefore, what are we concerned about? A democracy going down in the Middle East. So anyhow, the interviewer then turned to me and said, okay, young man, what are you doing? I said, I signed up to go to Israel as a mitnadev, a volunteer. But a week before the war, all flights to the Middle East were canceled, and therefore I can't go. So he said, well, if you go there, what are you going to do? So I said, whatever they ask me to do, I'll do. I have no idea. At that point, I got a swift kick under the table. And by the force of the kick, I'm sure it came from the head of the American Jewish War Veterans, because the American Jewish community in those days didn't have that type of kick. And he interrupted me and said, what this young man means to say is it is to go to Israel and teach them the principles of American democracy. Hogwash. I mean, the country's going down the drain. And what are you going to do? Take a slow boat to China and teach them the principles of American democracy? And I said to them, no. And he said to me, but how can you say no when you know that the president of the United States, Johnson, has declared neutrality? So I said to him, if it turns out that Israel's cause is just and Johnson's call is unjust, between justice and injustice, there can be no neutrality. Program was over and I limped out from that swift kick on the knee. In any case, all these passions converge, because by the time of the Six-Day War, the civil rights had made a major turning point. A Russian jury was getting coverage it never got before. And the war in Vietnam was getting worse, but moral opinion was turning against it. Politicians kept to it, but you had a hard time finding a moral spokesman in America after 67 who supported the war in Vietnam. So those people who fought on a moral basis were almost always united, because you hardly heard a significant moral voice who was opposed and supported it. We heard political voices, but not moral voices, which was not true years earlier. There were years earlier, people thought the domino theory about communism was really valid, and therefore we have to sacrifice a one country for the salvation of the world, salvation of capitalism or Christianity or religion or Judaism over communism. By 67, people stopped talking that way. And by the end of the war, nobody, as far as I know, except politicians were talking that way. So with this remarkable convergence in my life of my greatest passions as a student and my greatest passions as a Jew converging. In fact, I was founder of a group called the New York Chavura, and our motto was to pray and protest together. Meaning, people before that had people they could pray with but couldn't protest with them, different group. Or people they protested with but didn't pray with them. So we founded a group, and the goal was to pray and to protest together. And I emphasize this because in some sense, all these movements created my moral personality, and it was a powerful decade from the point of view of moral construction of identity. And that's our combination of Hanukkah and the moral passions of the 60s. I would love to open up the questions and comments. Even if you want to make a comment, not just a question, it's being written down here, then voice your inflect your voice upward so we can interpret it as a question.
Thank you, Professor Kimelman, for teaching us today, and especially for sharing a lot of personal anecdotes. I definitely enjoyed hearing from you. A few people have messaged me questions privately, feel free to just put them in the main chat. So the first question is, didn't the zealotry of the Maccabees degenerate into an authoritarian repressive regime that may have given the rabbis of the Talmud pause when asking and answering the question, what is Hanukkah? How would you connect that ambivalence to the events you mentioned in the 1960s?
It was a popular theory in Jewish historiography of the Maccabean period to explain the absence of reference to the Maccabees in the Talmud, because by the end of the Maccabean period, one of them turned against the Pharisees. And therefore, this turned them off to the military victory of the Maccabees. And what do they focus upon? The miracle of the oil, which in a sense excludes them from being so consequential. Now, as far as zealotry goes, I've never seen anybody combine the word zealotry with the Maccabees. The zealotry was normally combined with the Hasidim. The Hasidim began the revolt against the Maccabees, against the Greeks or the Hellenizing Jews, but they didn't have the military means nor the halachic wherewithal to solve the problem because they refused to fight on the Sabbath. The result was they were attacked on the Sabbath. So Mattathias issued the ruling according to the book of Maccabees that if we follow this, we're all dead. And he said, therefore, from now on, Jews have a right to defend their lives on the Sabbath, not to attack on the Sabbath. Once that ruling was issued, a large number of the Hasidim or Pietists joined his forces. And instead of having a family battle, it became a guerrilla warfare. They never really defeated the Greeks. That's a myth. But they were able to keep them out of Israel by virtue of international politics with Sparta and Rome, and because of conflicts of succession among the kings of Syria. So the Maccabees, if you want it, the only expression of zealotry, which you may be alluding to, was Hyrcanus, and apparently the forcible conversion or circumcision of members of Edom, which out of that rose King Herod as a boomerang effect. That may be the example he's pointing to, but otherwise the Maccabees are normally known as a middle group. The best evidence of that is all the Hasidim had Hebrew names, all the Hellenists, even the high priests, had Greek names, Onias, Menelaus, Jason, and all the Maccabees had two names, one Hebrew, one Greek, like modern American Jews.
Thank you. So another question that came to me was, what was the biggest mistake of the events you described and that we can avoid in facing today's societal challenges?
What is the biggest mistake? Is she referring to the 1960s?
It's a loaded question. I think in the events you described, I guess you can narrow it down to those.
Well, if I had to compare the 60s with what's going on now, is a point I made before. People were unified on a moral perspective, even if they were divided on a political perspective. In the last 6 months, maybe the last 4 years, at least specifically in the last 6 months, people's political perspective so influences their ethical perspective, it's amazing. You see that with regard to the presidency, with regard to Israel, and therefore I would say the moral ground which can unify diverse political positions has diminished, and the basis of conflict has grown. So if that's what the person is meaning, then I would love to go back to the 60s. And I would always ask when people articulate a position on anything, right? I always say, well, what does your opposition say? Can you defend their position? Just for the heck of it, Luke. Now, it's amazing how some people cannot put their feet into the shoes of others to even try to defend their position because it gets them so angry. So I have found out that when you get into an argument with somebody, the person who's wrong is probably the first person who shouts.
That's definitely a good piece of advice. So our next question, Ben Margolin asked two questions. So first, where the temple was rededicated, shouldn't Sukkot have been 7 days, not eight? And Sukkot, unlike Passover, has no built-in makeup capability. So how should this be?
Oh, that's a remarkable question. It's very learned, actually, the second part. Sukkot is 7 days, but Sukkot is attached to the eighth day called Shmini Atzeret. Both of them require initially the presence of the temple. Therefore, if you miss Sukkot, you miss Shmini Atzeret. So therefore, while Sukkot is a seven-day holiday, the unit as a subject of celebration is an eight-day unit. So therefore, the phrase became Sukkot de Kislev, Sukkot of the month of Kislev. Okay? Now, what she's talking about making up with regard to Korbanot, or like a Pesach Sheni, that's a halachic issue. This issue was, we were supposed to observe three pilgrimage holidays. We were not able to observe it this year of Sukkot. So Rosa Sadia would try to make it up by rededicating the temple. So it wasn't that kind of the very learned comment about compensation or making up for losses. Tashlumim is not really irrelevant here. It wasn't the halachic issue. It was a kind of a religious political issue. You missed it. Can you make it up? Okay. And so they observed the holiday for 8 days. Whether they brought, by the way, sacrifices, which would make it into a halachic issue during those 8 days of Kislev, we don't know. It could be it was 8 days of celebration. And by the way, it also explains on Sukkot and on Hanukkah, we say a full Hallel. On Pesach, we don't do a full Hallel, only the beginning part, not the latter part. By the way, to say a full Hallel on Hanukkah, it seems to me, and not say a full Hallel on Yom HaTzmut, Israeli Independence Day, a Jerusalem Day, is an expression of the fossilization of Judaism. How can you respond to the miracles of the past and not respond to the miracles of the present? In fact, if you look at the beginning of the blessing of Hanukkah, it says, Shasit Ravoteinu Bayamim Ahim. Then it says, Bizman Hazeh. Now, the phrase Bizman Hazeh, there's a debate what it refers to. One position says, at this time of the year, the 25th of Kislev. Other people say, no, just like you did miracles for us in the past, so you do for us in the present. Meaning, it's the miracles of the past which attune us to the possibility of miracles in the present. Therefore, it seems to me that if you study the book of Maccabees and you study the Six-Day War, if you had to make a relative statement about the miraculous nature, Six-Day War would clearly outshadow Hanukkah. And therefore, one says Hallel for one. Seems to me you should say Hallel for the other.
Thank you for that answer. Our next question is from Shulamit Reinhardt, and she asks, what about the women's movement that was also a moral movement of that time?
Well, that's the type of question that Shulamit Reinhardt would ask because she's so insightful in this issue. That's a fascinating question. I would say in the mid-60s, my experience, the woman's movement as a moral issue did not come up into the late 60s. In fact, I can recall in SDS, the Student Struggle for SDS, the Democratic Society, on people, women raising the women's issue. And this is the mid 60s, were shot down by the male leaders of the group, arguing it was diverting attention from the number one concern to a secondary concern. So it's a powerful question. I'm trying to recall my memory, and Shulamit was probably even a better memory of the subject. By the late 60s, I would say it emerged as a moral issue. In the mid 60s, the other passions of the day made that a secondary or tertiary, at least for men. And as I remember, for many women, that changed by the end. And I would call that its moral expansion of our consciousness more a product of the early 70s than the mid 60s, but maybe the late 60s was a transition issue here. In any case, I'm not a woman, and it didn't have the same formative impact that had upon me. And it may be worthwhile asking in a future event, some woman who went through this, asking how to what degree in the 60s that informed her moral consciousness and sense of being would be a powerful question and a powerful presentation.
Thank you. You may have just created a new Hillel event, so looking forward to hearing from someone on that topic in the future. Mark Cohen asks, at what point did you feel that the Vietnam War was morally wrong and why? And at what point did it seem to you as a different type of conflict than it did in the Koreas?
Okay, two questions here. Number one, I was too young during the time of the Korean War have any impact on me whatsoever. And I do not recall, although someone may be older than me, that in the early 1950s, the moral protests over the Korean War, like the Vietnam War. If I remember correctly, the Korean War was opposed as an unwinnable war. And that apparently even divided MacArthur and Truman on what could be done to win the war. The Vietnam War convinced many people politically when it was unwinnable, maybe by 68. But the moral outrage, we saw movies of people getting killed and couldn't understand what we were doing there, and the number of Americans getting killed, and the number of Vietnamese getting killed. And of course, if any of you have seen some of the powerful movies which came out in the 70s and 80s reflecting that, the moral dimension of the Vietnam War, I think far exceeded that of the Korean War from the point of view of American consciousness. But I cannot tell you because I didn't live through the Korean War. I mean, I was alive, but I wasn't old enough for it to make a mark upon me. Nor do I remember the type of protests, nor do I remember university centered, as was the Vietnam War. So could be. Now, the other case, the Vietnam War, by 67, 68, a large people said it was unwinnable. In 64, the issue was not whether it was winnable or not. It was considered an immoral war. So my own, for example, I wrote an essay called Judaism and Nonviolence, because I was so influenced by first by Gandhi, then by Martin Luther King. So I started exploring my own tradition on traditions of nonviolence in Judaism. And I know many people use that essay. In fact, a friend of mine to this day who used that essay to ask to be a conscientious objector. And he argued that is on his reading of Judaism, it does not allow him to participate in an immoral war. And he was granted exemption, primarily because I wrote the letter of exemption. But in any case, it was that original essay, which I wrote, and then I wrote a whole article on the right of protest. In other words, my scholarship in those days came straight out of my moral passions, nonviolence. Then I wrote about the ethics of protest. Then wrote several essays on the war in Judaism, talking about the just war. And in fact, in another year from now, Cambridge University Press is putting out a whole book on war and religious traditions. And they've asked me to write the essay on Judaism and just war. So all of these concerns of mine evolved out of my involvements in the 1960s. And I really am fortunate to be in a position in which my moral concerns and my academic concerns can converge and reinforce each other. And I feel myself blessed because of that.
Thank you. Our next question is from Melissa Fox, who says that the New York Times recently ran an article about how Hanukkah is celebrated in Greece with regard to the Greeks being beaten by the Maccabees. The Greek Jews evidently emphasized the fact that Antiochus was from Antioch, which was part of Syria/Turkey back then. So they say the Maccabees really beat the Syrians, not the Greeks. Would you say that the Greeks were innocent then?
When Alexander the Great died in 333 BCE, the Greek worldwide empire divided into three parts, a special name for it in Greek. There was Syria, Iraq was one, Egypt, the Ptolemies was the second, and the third was the country of Greece. Between Syria and Egypt was those say Syria-Palestine, which we call the state of Israel. The culture was Greek. The leaders spoke Greek. The urban culture was Greek. The language of the army was Greek. Greek culture dominated the ancient Middle East, somewhat like English culture dominated India in the 18 and 1900s. All your leadership and educated classes, right, all spoke English, dressed English, talked English, right? I mean, for non-Americans, they talked in excellent English, quite remarkable. In any case, therefore, to call them Greek, if Greek means a country of origin by geography, it's one thing. If Greek means by culture and language, it's something else. The great determiners are culture and language, not geography. After all, we speak English, but we don't what? Live in England. Would you call us a non-English culture? It'd be very strange to say that. So everybody calls them Greeks. They talk like a Greek. They walk like a Greek. They're probably Greeks. Even ducks are that way.
Thank you. So this will be our last question from Justin Hornstein. And he says, Professor Heschel or Rabbi Heschel was very concerned about poverty. Do you recall any perspectives or proposals from him that can impact policy today and going forward?
Oh, I wish I could answer that question. by the way, one of Heschel's great talks, you can find in the book called Moral Grandeur, I think is the book, is an essay, a lecture he gave at the Conference of Religion and Race in 1963 in Chicago. And he talked about the monstrosity of racism. What a great word, the monstrosity of racism, right? He has a lot of essays concerned with civil rights issues, war issues, Israel issues, Soviet Jewry issues. I gotta admit right now, I do not recall a specific essay dedicated to the problem of poverty. There are many essays dedicated to tzedakah and helping out people in general. But I mean, poverty as a political issue and how it the only connection he constantly made with Martin Luther King was, he says, you cannot solve the problem of racism without solving the problem of the Vietnam War, because the problem of racism and the problem of poverty go together. So that insight by the very significant. To this day, poverty and racism significantly converge. They don't totally overlap, but the problems of one frequently get expanded in the problems of the other. But I maybe somebody in the audience knows, but right now I do not know a specific essay dedicated only to the subject of poverty, independent of the other major moral concerns. That's probably a deficiency in my knowledge of the subject.
Okay. I want to thank you so much, Professor Kimelman, for speaking so movingly about your personal story and for teaching us about Al-Nisim and the Sidur. I hope it'll enhance the rest of everyone's Hanukkah.